This is lecture number 2 of chapter 14. It would be helpful to recall some key points from the previous lecture. So let's see what are those points. R is the set of real numbers. That means all numbers in the open interval minus infinity to infinity. Geometrically, you can think of all the numbers on the number line, right? R cross R carries all ordered pairs of real numbers where x, y are real numbers. R cross R carries the points of the type x, y where x, y belong to R. What is its geometry? Its geometry is xy plane, means all these points belong to xy plane, or you can say the xy plane is filled with these points. There is a one-to-one correspondence between the points in R cross R and xy plane. Okay. Likewise, what is R cross R cross R? This carries points of the type x, y, z where x, y, z are real numbers. Geometrically, it is three-dimensional space. These points lie in space. All right. So these are easy to understand. Next, I told you about functions. It would be helpful to recall some examples. Fx equal to root 1 minus x square. What is the domain of this function? Domain is given by x square less than equal to 1. Means the closed interval minus 1 to 1. And its graph geometrically is this semicircle from minus 1 to 1. Okay. If we increase one variable, say the function is of two variables x, y, and is given by 1 minus x square minus y square. Its domain is given by x square plus y square less than or equal to 1. This time its domain is unit circular disk. X square plus y square less than or equal to 1 means the unit circular disk in the xy plane. Radius 1. Graph of this function geometrically is this hemispherical surface. Okay. Next, if I increase one more variable, say z, and the function is given by 1 minus x square minus y square minus z square square root, what is the domain this time? X square plus y square plus z square less than or equal to 1. The points x, y, z which satisfy this condition lie in the domain, because for this range only, or you can say for this region only, this is a real number. If you put something greater than 1, then it becomes complex. So we are dealing with real valued function of real variables, so we need to keep it real. Now, what is the geometry of the domain? In this case, we can display the geometry of the domain only. What is the geometry of this thing? It is unit spherical region, centered at origin, radius 1, like this. This whole region in this unit sphere. Within and on this unit sphere represents the domain of this function. We cannot represent its graph geometrically. Mathematically, we can write the graph, but we cannot show that geometrically. There is no geometry for the graph of this function. Okay, so conclusion about functions is that if it is a function of one variable, domain is part of x-axis, just like in this example, the closed interval minus 1 to 1. Graph geometrically is a curve. For a function of two variables, domain is part of xy plane. In this example, this unit circular disk is the domain of the function, and graph is a surface. For three variable function, domain is some region in the xyz space. Okay, the graph has no geometry. No geometry for the graph. Okay, one more thing you can see, if I project this semicircle on x-axis, I get exactly the domain of the function minus 1 to 1. And if I project this hemispherical surface on xy plane, I get the unit circular disk. So these things you understand, that the graph is exactly mounted over the domain. Okay. Next point. Neighborhoods. Recall the neighborhoods. Neighborhood means in one dimension or one variable, any open interval carrying the point. If x naught is a real number on x-axis, then x naught minus delta to x naught plus delta. This open interval is neighborhood of x0. Neighborhood is basically a continuous collection of points around the given point without boundary. In neighborhood, we don't include the boundary. In two dimensions, say the point is x0, y0. This time, we need to consider a continuous collection of points around it. We have the choice. Either we can choose a circular neighborhood or we can choose a square neighborhood. Both ways, it's fine. If we choose a circular neighborhood of radius delta, then how can we write it? Square root of x minus x0 whole square plus y minus y0 whole square less than delta. This is circular neighborhood of x0, y0. If you want to write a square neighborhood, you can write it like this. Mod x minus x0 less than delta. Mod y minus y0 less than delta. So these are two convenient neighborhoods for x0, y0. Okay. We can use either of these. This also you can write in this form, x minus x0 less than delta. In 3D also you can think of, if I add one more, then it is cubical neighborhood of, or cuboidal neighborhood of x0, y0, z0. Likewise, if I add one more square term here like this, then it is spherical neighborhood of x0, y0, z0. Okay, so though we will need in two dimensions only, but you understand this thing. After neighborhoods, I told you about the interior, exterior, and boundary points. So let's see this one dimensional example, the closed interval 1 to 4. One and four are boundary points. Any point inside this interval is interior point, and any point outside it is exterior point. What is the meaning of interior point? If we can construct a neighborhood of the point that completely lies inside the set. For example, here I can construct a neighborhood of three that lies completely inside this. So it is interior point. Exterior point means there exists a neighborhood that lies completely outside S. For example, 5 is exterior point. 4 is boundary point, because whatever neighborhood you construct, it carries points inside it as well as outside it. Okay. So interior, exterior, and boundary points, you understand in one dimension. Same way, take one example in two dimensions. This is a set of points in the xy plane. Unit circular disk, you know. So what is center of this? 0, 0, radius is 1. This open circular disk. So any point on the boundary is a boundary point, because neighborhood of this point carries points inside the circle as well as outside the circle. Any point inside the circle is interior point. Why? Because you can construct a neighborhood that lies completely inside us. We need only one neighborhood, right? And exterior point means any point outside this circle. We can construct a neighborhood that completely lies outside this circle. So same way you can understand in 3D case. Okay, so this is easy. Now I tell you about level curves and contours. This I think I didn't discuss in the previous lecture. You know z equal to fxy geometrically is a surface, okay? Let's consider section of this surface with a plane z equal to c. Section of this surface with this plane is a curve that we call level contour. Naturally, it lies on the surface also. Section of this plane z equal to c, this plane, you understand, a plane parallel to xy plane. Okay, so section of this plane with the surface is a level contour. If I consider the same curve in xy plane z equal to 0, then we call it level curve. See one example, you will understand it. X square plus y square. Okay, let me take this one. Z equal to square root of 4 minus x square minus y square. Take the plane z equal to 1. See what is it geometrically. This you understand, hemisphere. Centered at origin. Graph of this function is hemisphere, centered at origin and radius 2. So how is it? This circular region is its domain, and this is the graph. Now, let's say here we have the intersection of the plane z equal to 1 with this surface z equal to 1. This plane is z equal to 1. It intersects this sphere in the circle. That circle is given by this. You can simplify also. So what do you get if you simplify these two? You get this is equivalent to x square plus y square equal to 3, isn't it? You put z equal to 1, square both sides. You get x square plus y square equal to 3. So this circle is x square plus y square equal to 3 in the plane z equal to 1. So this is a level contour. By definition, this is a level contour. If I consider the same circle in the xy plane, in the plane z equal to 0. Okay, this is the circle in which plane? Z equal to 1. If I consider the same circle in the plane z equal to 0, or you can say its projection in the xy plane or in the domain of the function, then this is called a level curve. So changing the values of C, you can get different level curves and level contours. So you understand it, right? Okay. Now, recall the concept of limit that I explained in the previous lecture. What is limit? Meaning of x tends to x0 means x not equal to x0, and in every neighborhood of x0 there are infinitely many values of x. X not equal to x0, but there are infinitely many values in every neighborhood of x0. If this happens, we say that x tends to x0. Okay, see one example to understand it quickly. Suppose x takes the values 0.9, 0.99, 0.999, and so on. Can I say x tends to 1 in this case? Why? Say here you have 0.9, then 0.99. Why? Because however small neighborhood I construct for 1, in this part, there would be infinitely many values of x. It is never equal to 1, that is for sure, whatever number of nines you consider after the decimal place. This part will carry infinitely many values of x. However small I construct, it doesn't matter. Okay, so in this case, you can write x approaches to 1 from the left, x tends to 1 minus left hand limit of x. Similarly, if x takes these values 1.1, 1.01, 1.001, and so on, say it is 1.1, 1.01, okay, 1.01, then in this part to the right of 1, however small neighborhood I construct for 1, this part carries infinitely many values of x. If x follows this pattern. So what does it mean? X approaches to 1 again, but this time from the right side. You write like this. That is the right hand limit of x. In one dimensional case, limit exists if left hand limit is equal to right hand limit. In two dimensional case, it is different. Suppose there is a point x0, y0 to which xy approaches. Think xy can approach to x0, y0 in how many ways? Infinitely many ways, because this time you are free to move to x0, y0 from any direction. Okay? Along arbitrary path. In one dimensional case, you are restricted to left hand side and right hand side because you are on x-axis. But this time, you can choose any path to approach to x0, y0. So there is no concept of left hand limit and right hand limit in the two dimensional case. Remember this. So in this case, limit exists if it is path independent. If you get different answers for the limit along to different paths, limit doesn't exist. Okay, you understand that thing. Now, see this one, limit of a function as x tends to x0. Recall the epsilon delta definition. What is that? Given epsilon positive, there exists delta positive such that mod of fx minus l is less than epsilon whenever 0 less than mod x minus x, 0 less than delta. Means, for any epsilon positive, we can find a delta positive depending on epsilon, such that for all x belonging to this neighborhood of x0, this is a neighborhood, corresponding fx values belong to epsilon neighborhood of L, right? Epsilon, this is fx belongs to L minus epsilon to L plus epsilon. So that is epsilon neighborhood of L. And also x not is not included in this neighborhood. So sometimes we call it deleted neighborhood of x0. Why we exclude it? Because the function need not be defined at the point where we are finding the limit. Limit of a function may exist even if the function is not defined at the point. So in the definition of limit, We say that suppose fx is defined in some neighborhood of x0 except possibly at x0. So it is better you exclude it in the definition, okay? So this is the definition in one variable case. In two variable case, similar is the definition. Recall that. Limit of fxy as xy tends to x0, y0 is L. If given epsilon positive, there exists delta positive, such that mod of fxy minus L is less than epsilon for 0 less than mod x minus x0 less than delta and 0 less than mod y minus y0 less than delta. Only the shape of neighborhood changes now. Here it is square neighborhood. Here it is open interval. You can choose the alternative neighborhood also, the circular one. Square root of x minus x0 whole square plus y minus y0 whole square less than delta. Okay. So you should be in a position to find some neighborhood epsilon such that for each xy in this neighborhood, fxy belongs to the epsilon neighborhood of L. The definition is same. Geometrically also you understand what is the geometry of this. For any epsilon positive, there must exist some delta positive such that the part of the curve corresponding to this neighborhood of x lies in the horizontal strip corresponding to epsilon neighborhood of L. Okay. And also, as you saw in the examples that I did in the previous lecture, this delta depends on epsilon and it goes to zero as epsilon goes to zero, as you choose epsilon smaller and smaller. So that means x tends to x0 and fx tends to L. The usual meaning that you understand from your 12th standard. Okay, so you have recalled the limit. It is also useful if you recall the geometry of the limit in these two examples. One is xy going to 0, 0. Okay, one dimensional case. Let me write one dimensional case first. X tends to 0, square root of 1 minus x square equal to 1. Limit of this function is 1. Geometrically, what is it? Graph of this function is semicircle, you know. X tends to 0, it can tend to 0 either from left or from right. Geometrically, what is happening? The part of the curve corresponding to this side of x or this side of the axis, this part hits at which point, approaches which point? 1. You can see from right side also the part of the curve or the curve approaches the point 1. Or you can say in simple words, the graph from both sides hits the same point. So limit exists and its value is 1. That you understand. Now see the two variable case geometry. Try to understand. Geometrically, what is it? Geometrically, graph of this function is hemisphere like this. XY is going to 0, 0. Now, XY is in the plane. XY can approach to 0, 0 from any direction. Okay, this is the point 0, 0. XY can approach to 0, 0 from any direction. Let's consider this one. So as xy tends to 0, 0 along this path, there is a curve on the surface that approaches to which point? 0, 0, 1. Or you can say z equal to 1. So from all directions, the corresponding curves to these paths approach to which point? 0, 0, 1. In simple words, you can say that the surface from all directions converges to this point as xy goes to 0, 0. That's why limit is 1. If the surface doesn't converge to the same point along to different directions, then limit doesn't exist, okay? So hope you understand the geometry. Now let's come to the methods for finding limits. I told you some methods. Epsilon delta method, you understand. Choose one epsilon positive and then find a delta positive depending on that, such that the delta neighbor for the delta neighborhood of x0, y0, the corresponding fxy belongs to the epsilon neighborhood of L. Okay. That problems we did. Second method that I told you is sandwich theorem. What is sandwich theorem? Fxy is the given function and you are interested to find its limit as xy tends to x0, y0. So see the limit of gxy as xy goes to x0, y0. Suppose this limit is L. This limit is also L as xy goes to x0, y0. In that case, you can say that limit of fxy is L as xy goes to x0, y0. But difficulty in applying sandwich theorem is that you have to construct these functions yourself. That could be a difficult thing for a given function. So only some limited problems can be done by sandwich theorem, okay? In epsilon delta approach also, sometimes you may need to use the polar coordinates. All right. Now, if a limit doesn't exist, if the limit of a function doesn't exist, in that case, what to do? This is important. Let me explain it through an example, though I did one example in the previous lecture. Let's see a different problem. Show that limit of x minus y or x plus y as xy goes to 0, 0 doesn't exist. It means this limit should be path dependent. Okay. This limit should be path dependent. So how to show that it is path dependent? There are two ways. Either choose two particular paths, or you can do by choosing a general path also. Xy goes to 0, 0. Let me choose a path, in fact, a line with slope m, y equal to mx. You know, y equal to mx passes through the origin. So suppose xy goes to 0, 0 along this path. What is the advantage of doing it? Now the limit is converted into a single variable. You can put y equal to mx and simplify it. X is cancelled. X goes to 0, x non-zero, so you can cancel x. And then no x is left, and answer of the limit is 1 minus m over 1 plus m. But it depends on m. It means if I change the slope of the line, answer of the limit changes, value of the limit changes. So what does it mean? This limit is path dependent, so it doesn't exist. You have to write like that. Another way, choose two particular paths. Say one path I choose x-axis and another path y-axis. If I choose x-axis, what is y on x-axis? Zero. So let's first solve this limit choosing along x-axis, choosing y equal to zero. What is the answer of this? If I choose y equal to zero, limit x tends to 0, x over x means 1. So along this path, answer of the limit is 1. If I choose another path, means let's choose along y-axis, this path, then I can choose x equal to 0 in the limit, and if I solve this limit, choosing x equal to 0, I get limit y tends to 0 minus y over y. Its answer is minus 1. So along these two paths, values of the limit are different. So limit doesn't exist. So you can choose either route, either do it by general path, okay, or by choosing two particular paths. See whatever way it is suitable to you, do it. Okay, both are okay. Now, topics of today's lecture. Continuity. Suppose fx is defined in some neighborhood of x0. Now, I'm not using the word fx is defined in some neighborhood of x0 except possible at x0. I'm saying explicitly the function is defined in some neighborhood of x0. Then fx is said to be continuous at x0. You can recall from your 12th standard. It is said to be continuous at x0 if limit x tends to x0, fx is fx0. Limit of the function as x tends to x0 equal to value of the function at x0. Okay. Meaning of limit you already understand. So just you have to determine the limit and show that it is equal to fx0. If this happens, the function is continuous. Same thing you can write in the two variable case. Suppose fxy is a function defined in some neighborhood of x0, y0. Then fxy is continuous at x0, y0 if limit of fxy as xy goes to x0, y0 is fx0, y0. Value of the function at the point x0, y0. Okay. Do you understand this? What is geometry of this? If the function is continuous at x0, it means graph of the function is a continuous curve in that region, in some neighborhood of x0, right? If this is continuous, then the surface is continuous about that point. Let's see the same examples. Consider this function, fx equal to square root of 1 minus x square. This function is continuous at 0. Why? Because limit of this function as x goes to 0 is 1 and f0 is also 1. Graphically, you understand that in the neighborhood of 0, this is a continuous curve. In fact, this function is continuous in the whole interval minus 1 to 1. So you see a continuous curve in the whole interval. So graphically, it is a continuous curve. Now see this example. What is the meaning of continuity of this function at 0, 0? Is it continuous? Check it. Limit of this function as xy goes to 0, 0 is 1. And this is also the value of the function at 0, 0. You can directly substitute x0, y0, you are getting 1. Function is continuous. Function is continuous. Right? So what does it mean? Geometrically, this is hemisphere. If it is continuous at 0, 0, so in this neighborhood, the part of the surface is continuous. This is a surface without break. Just like this, it is a curve without break in the neighborhood of 0. This is a surface without break in some neighborhood of 0, 0. But in the whole domain, x squared plus y squared less than or equal to 1, this function is continuous. That's why you're getting a continuous surface over the whole domain. What if it is not continuous? Let me redefine this function. Suppose I define this function like this. Square root of 1 minus x square when x non-zero. 0 when x equal to 0. What is the graph of this function? Same graph, except that this point is missing from the graph now. Because at 0, the value is given 0 here. This is empty. This is the actual point here corresponding to x equal to 0. Limit exists, no problem. From both sides graph, it's the same point. Value of the limit is 1. But f0 is what? 0. Not equal to 1. So this function is not continuous at 1. And you understand at this point there is a break in the curve. That's why it is not continuous. In two variable case, I can redefine this function. Say like this, when xy non-zero, this is the value of the function. 0 when xy equal to 0, 0. So this time graph of this function is this hemisphere missing this point. This the top point 001 is not on the surface. There is a hole, okay, at this point. Actually, that point is lying here. Think like this. You have hit something at this point, that point has fallen here. Isn't it? Or you can say it is a punctured hemispherical surface. Surface is converging to the same point from all directions. Limit of this function exists equal to 1. But this function is not continuous at 0, 0. Reason is that at 0, 0, now the value of the function is 0. That is not equal to 1. So this function is not continuous at 0, 0, right? Geometrically also you understand the surface is not continuous at 0, 0. There is a hole in the surface at that point. So geometrically you can understand the meaning of continuity. Also, you can do it by epsilon delta. How can you write this definition as epsilon delta definition? Given epsilon positive, there exists delta positive such that mod of fx minus fx0 is less than epsilon for mod x minus x0 less than delta. This time you need not to put 0 here, 0 less than, you need not to exclude x0. The function should be defined at x0. And in place of L, you have fx0. So same way you can apply epsilon delta definition to prove continuity. Okay, we will do a problem on it later. Same way you can write epsilon delta definition for continuity of the function of two variables. Okay, continuity is easy. It depends on the limit. You can do the problems. Now, very, very important. Differentiability of a function of two variables. I will also tell you the differentiability of a function of one variable. Let's see first the case of one variable. When you say function fx is differentiable, say at the general point x, when you say it, you have learned this in your 12th class. This function is differentiable at the point x if limit delta x tends to 0, fx plus delta x minus fx over delta x exist uniquely. And you call this limit derivative of the function and denote that by f prime x. You recall this definition of derivative? Yes. Good. Okay. This is the definition of differentiability of a function of one variable that you learned in 12th standard. But same thing you cannot do in case of two variables. If you write a similar limit for x, y, there is not one variable, there are two variables. So how to differentiate with respect to both the variables? So it would not be like this. We need to devise some new procedure that covers this definition as well as that helps us in defining differentiability of a function of two variables. So now I tell you the classical approach to define differentiability. See carefully. Suppose fx is defined in some neighborhood of x. Change in f means fx plus delta x Okay, let me write here. Change in f means in some neighborhood of x, fx plus delta x minus fx. This is a change in x around, change in f around x. If this change in f can be written in the form a delta x plus delta x times some function of delta x, where phi goes to 0 as delta x goes to 0. If this happens, then f is differentiable at x. Again, I repeat, if the change in f means this can be written in the form a times delta x plus delta x times phi delta x, where phi is a function of delta x and goes to 0 as delta x goes to 0. If this happens, then f is differentiable at x. A is independent of delta x. It could be some function of x, okay? Let's see how we recover this definition. But before that, let me tell you, we define A as the derivative of f with respect to x. So A should be equal to f prime x, right? Let's see how. If I divide this side as well as this side, this is left hand side, this is right hand side. If I divide both sides by delta x, this is left hand side after division by delta x, and right hand side a plus phi delta x, and then take the limit as delta x tends to 0. What do we get on the right hand side? This goes to 0. So we are left with a only. So this a is nothing but f prime x, you can check. That's why it is defined as derivative f with respect to x. So you see the definition that you learned in 12th standard is recovered with this general approach. Okay. One more thing you should notice here. A is f prime x, so I can replace this a by f prime x here. So a is f prime x. This is derivative of f with respect to x. There is one more thing that we define. Df equal to f prime x dx. In the limit, I can write it as infinitesimal. So this thing is defined as differential of f. Differential of f df. Derivative and differential are two different things. Derivative is f prime x, but f prime x dx is differential. You know f prime x represents the rate of change of function with respect to x, but df represents the actual change in f, okay? Same way, can we define differentiability of a function of two variables? In fact, you can write yourself similar definition for the differentiability of fxy at xy. Suppose fxy is defined in some neighborhood of xy. And suppose change in f means fx plus delta x, comma y plus delta y minus fxy can be written in the form a times delta x, b times delta y, plus delta x times phi delta x, comma delta y, plus delta y times psi delta x, comma delta y, where phi and psi functions of delta x, delta y, such that both tend to 0 as delta x, delta y tend to 0. If this happens, we say that f is differentiable at xy. See it carefully. It's similar to this. Okay? It is just extension of this. Same way we can define differentiability of a function of three variables. Now next thing, let's determine these a and b in some limits. If I put delta y equal to 0, in both these sides, left hand side as well as right hand side, and then divide both sides by delta x. Let's first take delta y equal to 0 on the left hand side. You get this expression. Then divide it by delta x. What is on right hand side? A times delta x is gone because you have divided by delta x. Delta y you have already taken 0. So you are left with a plus phi delta, phi is now function of delta x only. So what happens if you take limit delta x tends to 0 on both sides? Phi is also gone. So a is this limit, and we call this a as partial derivative of f with respect to x, very important. Or we also denoted it by f subscript x. In left hand side and right hand side, I have taken delta y equal to 0, means no increment in y. Then I divided both sides by delta x, and then I have taken limit as delta x tends to 0. Right hand side, I get a only. We denote this limit by partial f over partial x. This symbol is partial, but people call it del f or del x or some curly f or curly x, but actually you should call it partial f. Okay, this is different from this. D is different. D stands for total derivative, and this is partial symbol. So use the symbols carefully when you are doing partial derivative. Why we are calling it partial derivative of f with respect to x? You see, I have taken 0 increment in y. I have done the partiality. You can think like this. I have treated x my main variable and y as a constant. That's why it is partial derivative. Same way, you can get the value of b. What is value of b? Can you write yourself? This time take delta x equal to 0, divide both sides by delta y, and then take the limit delta y going to 0. So no increment in x, delta y is increment in y, minus fxy divided by delta y. You will get b, value of b, and this is partial derivative of f with respect to y, also denoted by fy. F subscript y. Okay, so these a and b are partial derivatives of f with respect to x and y. Let me replace here fx and fy. Okay, so here we called a as derivative of f. Here there is nothing like derivative. Here you have partial derivatives. For two variable function, we cannot say derivative. There is something like f prime. There are two derivatives which are partial derivatives, fx and fy. But of course you can define differential in the same way. What is differential of this function in the two variable case? Df equal to, take these two, this part, del f over partial f or partial x, in place of delta you can write dx, plus partial f or partial y dy. Very, very important formula for the differential of f. In one variable, differential is f prime x dx. Two variable differential is fx dx plus fy dy. Okay. So this is the way we define differentiability, and this is the way the partial derivatives appear naturally. Now, notice something very important regarding the existence of, or you can say differentiability of f. A function of two variables is differentiable when this condition is satisfied, right? In this condition, partial derivatives appear naturally. It means existence of partial derivatives is must for the differentiability. So I can say necessary condition for differentiability. What is necessary condition? Fx and Fy exist at the point where we are looking for the differentiability. So existence of partial derivatives is the necessary condition for the differentiability. You can see from here, suppose fx doesn't exist, so naturally the function cannot be differentiable. Okay, same way if fy doesn't exist, function is not differentiable. So remember this, existence of partial derivatives of f with respect to x and y is essential for the differentiability. Now, geometry. For one variable function f prime x, you understand it represents slope of the tangent to the curve. But here there is no such geometry. What we can do, we can tell geometry of fx and fy. I will tell you later. So as such, there is no geometry of the derivative of the two variable function. Okay. In fact, there is no derivative. There are partial derivatives. So we can discuss the geometry of fx and fy. Though there is further associated geometry with the df also, you will see that later. All right, this part is very important. See it carefully. Now we define differentiability of a function of one variable and two variable. In this case, differential is f prime x dx. In this case, differential is partial f over partial x dx plus partial f over partial y dy. These limits are very important. The definitions of partial derivatives, fx is given by this limit, fy is given by this limit. So in this process, I have defined partial derivatives also. Okay, now let's see some problems, how we can discuss the differentiability of a function using the definition. Okay, let's see one example for one variable function. Prove that fx equal to x square is differentiable function for all x using this definition. Let's solve it. The change in f, fx plus delta x minus fx. What do we get? X plus delta x whole square minus x square. If I simplify it further, I get 2x times delta x plus delta x whole square. That I can write delta x into delta x. X square is cancelled. Can you compare it with this one? This is your a. So what is a here? A, or you can say prime x, is 2x. A times delta x plus delta x times some function of delta x. So this is your phi. Phi is going to 0 clearly as delta x goes to 0. So it means the condition for differentiability is satisfied. So we can say that the function is differentiable for any given x. And what is its derivative? Up to this, you can say the function is differentiable. What is derivative of this function? F prime x, that is 2x. Same way you can do for a function of two variables. Suppose the function is x square plus y square. So what do you need to solve? Similar calculation, fx plus delta x comma y plus delta y minus fxy. This is the change in fxy, okay, around xy. So if you simplify, what do you get? Same way you can do the calculation yourself. I'm writing the final part. Check it yourself. You will get 2x delta x plus delta x into delta x plus 2y delta y plus delta y into delta y. You can see this is your phi, this is psi, this is a, this is b. Phi and psi clearly go to 0 as delta x delta y go to 0. What does it mean? This function is differentiable at x, y. Okay? And also you can write the partial derivatives. What is partial derivative with respect to x? 2x? Because this a is nothing but fx. partial derivative with respect to x, and partial derivative with respect to y is 2y. Directly also you can understand partial derivative of f with respect to x means treat y as constant. So if you differentiate this with respect to x, treating y as constant, you get 2x. Partial derivative with respect to y means treat x as constant this time, so derivative is 2y. All right, so this way you can talk about differentiability of a function of two variables. Now, one thing you have noticed that existence of partial derivatives is compulsory for the differentiability of a function of two variables. So that is necessary condition, that is not sufficient. Only, you see, if the partial derivatives do not exist, or you can say one of the partial derivatives doesn't exist, in that case function is not differentiable. Okay? What is other way around? Means, can we construct a sufficient condition also? By saying that condition, can we say that the function is differentiable? Let's do some problems, then I will go to that point. Okay, the sufficient condition. Let's solve this problem. Given a function fxy equal to x square plus y square over mod x plus mod y when xy non-zero, and value of this function is 0 when xy equal to 0, 0. What you need to do, show that this function is continuous at 0, 0, but fx at 0, 0 and fy at 0, 0 do not exist. Okay, let's first prove its continuity. How to prove the continuity? Let's go by definition. In definition, what you do? For a given epsilon positive, you have to set up a delta positive such that mod of fxy minus the limit means minus L is less than epsilon for the delta neighborhood of xy. So here, its limit, what do we want the limit for continuity? F0, value of the function at 0. So what is it? Let's simplify it further. X square plus y square over mod x plus mod y. F0 is given 0. Okay. I can remove the modulus. I'm sure that this quantity is positive. Okay. So after that, I can write x square plus y square over mod x plus mod y. If I add 2 times mod x mod y, it makes no difference. The quantity may be bigger or equal to the previous one, right? But after this step, I can write mod x plus mod y whole square over mod x plus mod y. This simplifies to mod x plus mod y. This can be written less than epsilon if or for mod x less than epsilon by 2, mod y less than epsilon by 2. Correct. Let's choose this as delta. So what you have found, limit of this function is 0, correct? Because till this step you understand that limit of this function is 0. Actually, for given epsilon positive, you have found a delta positive such that mod of fxy minus f0 is less than epsilon for this delta neighborhood of 0, 0, isn't it? Okay, let me write it separately. You have shown that x square plus y square over mod x plus mod y minus 0 or minus f0 is less than epsilon for mod x minus 0 less than delta, mod y minus 0 less than delta. This is delta neighborhood of 0, 0. So for this delta neighborhood of 0, 0, mod of the function minus 0 is less than epsilon. This means limit of this function is 0, or you can say f0. So this function is continuous at 0, 0. Okay. So this way you can use epsilon delta definition to prove continuity at a point. So you have shown continuity. Next thing, partial derivatives of this function do not exist at 0, 0. Again, you need to use the limit definition. What is limit definition of partial derivative at any point, x, y? Limit delta x tends to 0, in place of delta x, I'm using h, easy to write, okay? It doesn't matter what symbol you use. Fx plus h, comma y minus fxy minus fxy over h. This limit gives you the partial derivative of f with respect to x at the point xy. In place of delta x, I've used h everywhere. Okay. Same way you can write partial derivative of f with respect to y. This time, choose a different symbol for your convenience. K tends to 0, increment is in y this time, minus fxy divided by k. Remember these definitions, okay, for partial derivatives. Now here you want to first find fx at 0, 0. So according to this definition, you should write s tends to 0. In place of xy, put 0, 0. So you are left with fh, 0 minus f0, 0 divided by h. What is fh0 from here? Calculate it. fh0 from here. fh0. Y is 0, x is h. So you are left with h square over mod h. Okay, put here h square over mod h. F 0, 0 is 0. So you can put 0 divided by, whole thing is divided by h. So put here h. You are left with limit h tends to 0, h over h. You know that this limit doesn't exist because as h tends to 0 from the left side, you get minus 1. You know this limit. Left-hand limit is minus 1, right-hand limit is plus 1. So this limit doesn't exist. You can write those steps, right? Limit doesn't exist means partial derivative of f with respect to x at 0, 0 does not exist. Same way, you can do fy at 0, 0 yourself. Okay, so in that case also limit doesn't exist. Only difference would be it would be k square over mod k into k. Okay, so k over mod k again using this definition. So function is continuous at 0, 0, but partial derivatives do not exist. So this example is a counterexample showing that continuity of the function doesn't imply the existence of partial derivatives. Now let's see another example. Fxy is xy over x square plus y square when xy non-zero, 0 when x. This time we need to show that this function is not continuous at 0, 0. But partial derivatives exist. Fx at 0, 0 and Fy at 0, 0 exist. This is a reverse problem. Reverse example, you can say, in comparison to the previous example. Let's see whether it's continuous or not. So if it is not continuous, what does that mean? Limit of this function doesn't exist at 0, 0, because value I am saying it is defined. So how to show that limit of this function is xy going to 0, 0 does not exist? It's an easy problem, you've already done, you can show it. Let's choose the here xy is going to 0, 0, so let's choose the path y equal to mx. Along this path, if xy goes to 0, 0, what happens? Limit x goes to 0, in place of y you can choose mx. X square plus m square x square. You can see x square is cancelled from the numerator and denominator. Answer of this limit is m over 1 plus m square depends on m, means depends on the path. If the limit is path dependent, it does not exist. This way you can write your explanation. Or you choose two different paths and show that there are two different values of the limit. So because limit of this function is xy goes to 0, 0 doesn't exist, so function is not continuous at 0, 0. That is very clear. Now you need to find these two partial derivatives. Fx at 0, 0 is what? By definition, as I wrote in the previous example, you can say that limit this partial derivative at 0, 0 is limit h tends to 0, f h comma 0 minus f 0, 0 divided by h. So what is it? F h 0, if you simplify from this, you get 0, right? 0 over h square plus 0. F 0, 0 is 0 divided by h. So you get this limit 0, right? Yes. So partial derivative exists and its value is 0. Same way you can find partial derivative of f with respect to y at 0, 0. Again, you will see that it is 0. So in this example, the function is continuous at 0, 0, not continuous at 0, 0, but partial derivatives exist. So previous example and this example show that continuity and partial derivatives are not connected with each other, right? A function may be continuous, partial derivatives do not exist. Partial derivatives exist, function is not continuous. This is possible. How these things are connected with the differentiability of the function? Now I'm writing the sufficient condition for the differentiability. Sufficient condition. Condition for the differentiability of fxy. Fx and fy are continuous also. When these are continuous, automatically these exist, okay? If fx and fy are continuous, then fxy is differentiable. So using partial derivatives, you can use this result. We will not prove it, okay? This is a result which says that continuity of fx and fy implies the differentiability of fxy. You can use it. Now, to prove differentiability of a function, there are two ways. Either go by definition, the change in f definition, express that in a times delta x, b times delta y plus, okay? You know that definition. Other way, find partial derivatives and show that the partial derivatives are continuous at that point. Both ways you can do. That is the way to prove the differentiability at a point. Function is not differentiable at a point. How can you show that? One way is that show that either fx or fy do not exist. Okay? Do not exist. Either both or one of these does not exist. In that case, function is not differentiable because you know that existence of these partial derivatives is must for the differentiability. There is another thing. Show that the function is not continuous. F is not continuous. If you can show this, then also you can say that the function is not differentiable. Why? In one variable, I think you know this result. Differentiability implies continuity. Do you recall it? I can illustrate it very quickly. You'll understand. If a function is differentiable, then what happens? This change in f can be represented in the form f prime x into delta x plus delta x times some function of delta x. Let's take the limit as delta x tends to 0 on both sides. So left hand side, this is the limit. Limit applies on this only. This is free from delta x. Right hand side, because you are saying that f prime x exists, this means this also goes to 0 as delta x goes to 0. The right hand side limit is 0. But what does it show? Value of the function means fx is equal to limit of the function, isn't it? So differentiability implies continuity. Same way you can show for a function of two variables. It's easy. Differentiability implies continuity, but continuity doesn't imply differentiability. It means if a function is differentiable, it is necessarily continuous. If it is not continuous, I should write here not continuous, then you can say that f is not differentiable. Because a differentiable function is always continuous. So you can use either of these two approaches, okay, to show that the function is not differentiable. If it is differentiable, then there are two ways to show that. Show that fx and fy are continuous. One way. Other way is the definition. Change in f you should express in that form. Okay. Not differentiable. Again, there are two ways. Either show that fx, fy do not exist, or f is not continuous. You know how to check the continuity, etc. Okay. So remember these points. These are very important. One more thing. Why a continuous function need not be differentiable? Do you know some example in one variable case? Do you recall the graph of mod x, the v-shaped function? This function is continuous at 0. There is no break in the graph. But this function is not differentiable at 0. You know why geometrically? What is f prime x for this? Mod delta x over delta x. You can check it. You know this limit doesn't exist. F prime x at which point? 0. Not at other points. At 0 you can find by definition. Using the limit definition, you get this limit. This limit doesn't exist as delta x goes to 0. So function is not differentiable. Geometrically, function continuous, not differentiable, that means there is a corner. It is not smooth. The tangent is not unique. From left side, this is the tangent. Right side, this is the tangent. Left hand derivative, if you calculate, you are getting minus 1 slope of this line. Right hand side derivative, if you calculate, you get plus 1 slope of this line. Not equal, not unique tangent, sharp corner. One variable, you can understand this way. Same way, in two variable case, what would happen if the function is not differentiable but continuous? The surface is continuous around that point, but there is a corner at that point, or you can say there is a sharpness. There is another thing that is called tangent plane that we'll discuss later. So tangent plane would not exist at that point. You can understand this way the geometry of these things. Okay. Now, final point of today's lecture, the geometry of the partial derivative. Geometry of fx, say at some point x0, y0. Geometrically, z equal to fx, y is a surface, you know it. Finding partial derivative with respect to x means treating y as a constant. See, what are these two together? These two represent what? This is a surface, this is a plane. Plane parallel to? exit plane. Say z equal to fxy surface like this. I'm making like this for illustration. A good looking plot you can see in the lecture notes. Okay. This is the surface z equal to fxy in space. Y equal to y0 is a plane parallel to xz plane, correct? Parallel to xz plane. Intersection of the two is this curve. This curve is given by these two, isn't it? So finding partial derivative of f with respect to x means what? You can say that because y is constant, you are finding dz over dx, or let me write it curve separately, z equal to fx comma y0 is this curve. So doing its derivative with respect to x means you are finding dz over dx at x0. But this is ordinary derivative. So it should be slope of the tangent to this curve. Of course, this curve lies in which plane? Y equal to y0. This plane is y equal to y0. So geometrically, partial derivative with respect to x at this point represents slope of the tangent to this curve. Isn't it? Overall, this is a point in 3D. What is this point? X0, y0, and z is fx0, y0. Anyway, now you understand the geometry, okay? So it's simple to understand. So we have done some very important things today. We have done continuity and differentiability of a function of two variables, and we have done a nice comparison with the one variable case. So hope you have understood all these things very well. So we will continue this discussion in the next lecture. Thank you.